Simon & Schuster Audio presents Movie Nights with the Reagans, a memoir by Mark Weinberg. Read by George Newbern, with an introduction read by the author.
Introduction. Nancy Reagan's Last Goodbye, August 2015. My rental car and I are finding our way down the streets of Bel Air on a trip I hadn't taken for years. Back then, when I worked for President and Mrs. Reagan, every one of these trips seemed important. Yet this one was perhaps the most important of all. I didn't know it for certain, of course, and I sure hoped it wasn't true, but I had a feeling this would be the last time I would see Nancy Reagan alive. The pop culture notion of the Reagan's former neighborhood is of multi-story mega mansions tucked behind elaborate gates and exotic foliage. There are, in fact, many homes like that. Elizabeth Taylor once lived nearby. But by no means does that image apply to all of them. That includes my destination that summer afternoon, the home of Nancy and Ronald Reagan. With all due respect, if tourists were driving through Bel Air to ooh and ah over houses, they would not give the Reagan home a second look. It's a very ordinary house, an onlooker said once when the former first couple moved into their multi-million dollar digs at 668 St. Cloud Road in January 1989. By the time I make this drive again, the former president has been gone for more than 10 years. But that doesn't matter. I still see the house as theirs. His widow clearly felt that way, too. She'd have never dreamt of abandoning the comparatively modest three-bedroom ranch house they shared a couple of miles from Century City, where the former president maintained his office after leaving the White House, and about an hour's drive from the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library and Museum in Simi Valley. There's a nondescript metal mailbox in front of the gate, and at the appointed hour, I pull into the driveway, past the security station after having been cleared, and make the short drive to the front door. In earlier days, whenever I came to the house, I'd knock on the large, round, brass door knocker, and either the president or Mrs. Reagan, sometimes both, would open the door without pretense and show me in. Whenever I left, one or both always walked me to the door and stood there, waving, until my car was out of sight. So it was no surprise to me on such a balmy day that a smiling Nancy Reagan, at this point largely confined to a wheelchair, was at the door to greet me again. Standing beside her were a home health care aide and her housekeeper. As her health declined, Mrs. Reagan had allowed very few meetings like this one, which she knew in advance was an interview for this book. Her staff didn't want her to be overwhelmed with requests from former aides and old friends, so my visit was kept quiet. As I understand it, it was the last interview she gave. I didn't know what to expect, but even at 94, Nancy Reagan looked and acted like, well, Nancy Reagan. Her hair was a little less puffy than when she was first lady, but still very nicely styled. And her makeup, essentially only lipstick, looked perfect. She wore an orange blouse and cream-colored pants, simple earrings, and her wedding band. Her eyes and smile were warm. And her voice, while slightly softer, was otherwise exactly as it had always been, warm and welcoming. Just hearing it immediately evoked so many fond memories of our many years together, especially when she laughed. As I saw her again, my thoughts returned to the first time I'd met her, when I joined the 1980 Reagan presidential campaign. We had not gotten off to the best of starts. We had landed somewhere during our dizzying cross-country campaigning, and the Reagans were asked to stay aboard the plane for a short while because their motorcade was not yet ready. It was essentially just the two of them at the front of the plane, and I thought I saw an opportunity to ingratiate myself with Governor Reagan's influential wife. I walked up the aisle, presented her with some trinkets I had found in a hotel gift shop, and said, "These might be fun for your grandchildren." Mrs. Reagan accepted them, looked at me, and said, "Thank you," in a perfunctory manner. I strutted to the back of the plane, feeling cocky because I had made myself known to the candidate's wife. As soon as I got off the plane, however, another staff member came up to me. "You're a fool," he said. "What do you mean?" "Don't you realize Mrs. Reagan doesn't have any grandchildren?" He explained that the grandchildren were the children of Michael Reagan, a son from the governor's first marriage, to the actress Jane Wyman. My heart sank. Needless to say, I never mentioned grandchildren to the First Lady again. Mrs. Reagan did not hold that incident against me. That may surprise some people who bought into the caricature, created by some critics and carried out in the press, portraying her as some sort of Cruella de Vil. Over the years, I'd learned many times how very wrong and unfair that characterization was. "I'm not really walking very much anymore," she confessed, as we met for that final time in California, "so I hope you'll forgive me for not opening the door." "Of course," I replied, and leaned down to kiss her on the cheek. "I brought you something. An orchid, one of her favorite flowers." "Oh, how beautiful. Thank you, Mark." She held it for a second until the housekeeper reached down to take it to her bedroom. Probably by design, the house felt as if the president might be just down the hall, walking into the room at any moment with a quip or story on hand. This was very much the house, after all, of a woman still mourning a husband who, because of Alzheimer's disease, was tragically lost to her long before he actually died. "Where shall we go?" Mrs. Reagan asked. "How about in here?" She motioned toward the den. Outside the room hung Norman Rockwell's famous painting of the president done in 1968 when Reagan was governor of California, which had been there for as long as I could remember. The den, too, was precisely the way it was the day the Reagans moved into the home. Two of the walls were lined with bookshelves holding many leather-bound collections of books on various topics. There were a few decorative silver plates and framed photos interspersed among the shelves. Mrs. Reagan with Queen Elizabeth II. The two had become good friends over the years, and another of the Reagans with Pope John Paul II at the Vatican. The den had dark paneling, but the room was very bright because one wall was glass and looked onto the backyard. There was a small fireplace tucked into one wall and a TV hidden by the paneling. On the large red and white couch sat an embroidered pillow that bore a map of the United States, highlighting the 49 states Reagan won in 1984, all but Minnesota, Democratic opponent Walter Mondale's home state. The words, "You ain't seen nothing yet," one of the 84 re-election campaign slogans, and an embroidered inscription, "Love, Fran and Ray." The pillow was a gift from Fran and Ray Stark, he, the legendary Hollywood producer who, many lifetimes ago, discovered Barbara Streisand and gave her a film career. Ray Stark was involved with dozens of motion pictures, including West Side Story, The Misfits, Funny Girl, The Way We Were, and Steel Magnolias. In front of the couch stood a very large coffee table, piled high with videos of movies in which Ronald Reagan had starred. Nearby was a round wooden table, on which sat a beautiful orchid plant and some hand-painted enamel boxes. The home health care aide gently wheeled Mrs. Reagan to this table, and I took a chair right next to her. After I updated her, at her insistence, on my wife and children, we came to the reason for my visit. I reminded her that I was writing this book, the story of the Reagan presidency through the movies we watched at Camp David, the presidential retreat nestled in the wooded hills of Maryland, about an hour northwest of Washington, D.C. "I know you are," she said, smiling. Her eyes sparkled when she talked about our weekends at Camp David. For all that has been written about the Reagans over the years, it was an aspect of their lives about which little was or is known. She seemed eager to relive the memories and to see them live on in print. That was such a special time. Indeed it was, which is the reason I wanted to write this book. It had been 34 years since I was a 23-year-old White House press aide assigned to travel with the Reagans to Camp David for the weekends, and became one of the few members of the administration who saw them off guard and up close. The idea of having a press office staffer accompany the president to Camp David was White House Press Secretary Jim Brady's. He thought it was essential that there be a point of contact with the chief executive at all times, and someone who could act as his eyes and ears just in case. Because Jim and his two deputies were married with young children, the role fell to the two assistant press secretaries, David Prosperi and me. For the first year of the administration, we alternated weekends, but after David left the White House staff for a big job in the private sector, word came that the missus is comfortable with Mark, so I was more than happy to go every weekend. I was assigned to a small cabin called Sycamore, located down the path from Aspen Lodge, the presidential residence, and just a stone's throw, literally, from Laurel Lodge, the main and largest building where there was a big living room with a brick fireplace, conference room, presidential office, and dining room for senior staff. Almost every weekend, a small number of the staff spent our evenings with the Reagans doing one of the things they loved best, watching movies. Over the 8 years, we watched nearly every major motion picture of the 1980s. From 9 to 5, to E.T., to Back to the Future, to Raiders of the Lost Ark, to Ferris Bueller's Day Off. The last film we saw together, the 363rd in their 8 years, was Cattle Queen of Montana. The last wasn't an 80s film, but one of the president's golden oldies, as he liked to call the films he'd starred in. And yes, we did watch other films in the Reagan repertoire, Canute Rockne All-American, Hellcats of the Navy, and Bedtime for Bob.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.